like to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Sherry Beaudreau. Dr. Beaudreau is board certified in neuropsychology with clinical and research experience in late-life psychiatric and neurocognitive disorders. She's a clinical professor affiliated in the Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences at Stanford University School of Medicine, and an honorary associate professor in the School of Psychology at the University of Queensland and Brisbane, Australia. She conducts research in the Sierra Pacific Mental Illness Research Education and Clinical Center, a translational research center devoted to older veterans with cognitive impairment. The overarching goal of Dr. Beaudreau's research program focuses on the interface between psychiatric symptoms and neurocognitive processing in older adults to inform the development of psychiatric behavioral intervention. Please welcome Dr. Sherry.
Great. Well, I'm excited to be here today, and I just want to thank the committee for inviting me. I remember coming there a little while ago, over 10 years ago, because of those doctoral fellows, and because I actually speak in this forum. I'm going to speak to you today about late-life anxiety and neurocognitive impairment. This is an area that I'm very excited about, and hopefully you'll learn a lot about. You don't hear about anxiety quite as often. And let's see, so to advance the slides, is there a way that I do that? Big green button. Okay. Point down. It's the top of anxiety. Let's see. Okay, there we go. Okay, fantastic. Okay, so there are two goals I had for our 2-minute presentation here, which was first to talk about some of the latest scientific evidence that's out there about neurocognitive impairment and anxiety for older adults. And I also want to give you some exciting information about some of the latest treatments, in particular because I'm a psychologist, I'm going to be focusing more on behavioral interventions. I'm also going to mention studies that talk about not only older adults with subjective memory impairment and anxiety, those also mild neurocognitive disorders or major neurocognitive disorders. And it's really exciting to see that there are a number of treatments being developed for persons with dementia who also have anxiety. So sort of a really exciting area right now. Let's see. Disclosures. So we're just in this section just talking about empirical support that links anxiety and cognitive function in older adults. In particular, I want you to come away from this understanding why you should care about it. I'm guessing I'm speaking, kind of preaching to the choir here. I think you all understand that this is important, but I think sometimes it's lesser thought about or actually can be sort of ignored, not picked up on for anxiety. I think depression is more likely to be diagnosed or seen. When in fact, I'm going to do a poll, right? We're going to do a show of hands. So if you want to find out from your knowledge, just to poll you what the most common mental health disorders are in older adults. So for a show of hands, how many of you would give alcohol substance use disorders as the most common? Mood disorders, which is depression. Anxiety disorders. Major cognitive disorders. And then both mood and anxiety. Okay. I tricked you all. Oh, that went backward. I tricked you all because actually anxiety disorders are much more common than mood disorders. So technically, I mean, I guess it would be a technical. Whole mood and anxiety disorders are most common, but they're not equally prevalent. So actually, anxiety disorders, you find in a 12-month prevalence study, and I like the 12-month prevalence, because we're not asking people to do retrospective accounting of disorders that they've had in the past, so it's a little less of that. For anxiety disorders, they're definitely most common. Another point to make, and this is actually probably most important, and it ties into, and this is kind of hit upon a little bit in the previous presentation, it's not just a matter of whether or not a person has a full-blown anxiety disorder, but I think it's important to talk about the clinically significant symptoms of anxiety, same for depression. And the reason that I think many of you know is that those symptoms can, and they do often affect functioning in older adults, so as a psychologist, I might be more likely to treat somebody who has symptoms that don't quite diagnostic criteria, but they're there, and they seem to be affecting functioning. And what you find is across different settings, so residential care patients, someone seeking home care management, there's a study that had multiracial older adults more in the community, and you find the rates are pretty high if you just look at clinically significant symptoms. I'd argue this is quite common, even more so than we give it credit. And you can imagine, these are some of the common symptoms or the symptoms that we think about that kind of cluster that can relate to anxiety disorders. You can see there's one big box here, a big yellow box. And one of the issues, I think, oftentimes when people go in for a medical appointment, we can see assuming, well, you're having these somatic and physiological symptoms, so it's probably just their medical condition. We know that multi-morbidity, that is having one or more medical conditions in addition to your anxiety, you know, that's much more likely to have anxiety if they're highly related. So I think oftentimes we assume that that doesn't really count, but I can't quite understand actually how these things work. Certainly there are other symptoms as well. You might have somebody who's worried, showing different concerns, nervousness, and different feelings, maybe having fear, avoiding behaviors. Sometimes one that's less appreciated, reassurance-seeking behavior, where maybe, you know, this is the person who may call the clinic all the time to check up on things and feeling pretty anxious. So these are some of the general symptoms to give you some background on that. We conducted a review paper. This is 10 years old now, but the main point I just wanted to have you take home with you about this, that we've known for a while that anxiety is a common, as is, was mentioned in the previous presentation, was a common neuropsychiatric symptom in dementia. And based on a number of studies that have been looking at this over the years, it's as high as 23% of older adults with kind of an MCI, so mild neurocognitive disorder, around cognitive impairment, and as high as 80% in dementia in some studies. So quite common. And then, of course, there's the issue that late-life anxiety is associated. Late-life anxiety is also associated with a number of risk factors for cognitive dysfunction. So the big one, and the MDs in the audience, but also I think for those of you who are MDs, know that benzodiazepines are not so great, and that can be related to not only cognitive impairment, but also mortality. Co-occurring depression, which is a risk factor for mortality as well as cognitive dysfunction, and multiple medical problems I mentioned. Okay. Briefly want to mention here too that we did a study where we tried looking at the specific types of neuropsychiatric symptoms, and one of the issues was just the sample size and power. So it was harder to really see, we had to be careful with that, but at least when you look at neuropsychiatric symptoms all together, older adults already had in the study was cognitive impairment, not dementia, which was kind of a loose clustering of MCI and other kind of various non-dementia memory issues, and we found that the risk of conversion from that basically almost like a mild neurocognitive disorder to major neurocognitive disorder or dementia was significantly associated with neuropsychiatric but it was not associated with APOE, the apolipoprotein gene. So now what's interesting, this slide here, I just want to point out because there was a study a few years back, I think out of the Netherlands, where they looked longitudinally to see if anxiety was a predictor of cognitive impairment and conversion to dementia, and they found it wasn't. So the word on the street for a while in the research community was that while anxiety was related to cognitive impairment and maybe some decline, that it wasn't a risk factor. Well, lo and behold, through PETCIS, Julie Weberall, RDF, Peterson, they had looked at the Swedish adoption and twin study data. And what they found is that if you look further out, if you have a long enough follow-up, you do find that it is a risk factor for dementia, which I think is really important to think about. I think for some of our discussion, the panel will probably play into that discussion. I want to make sure I'm moving along. Briefly, I made sure it says in the body, I'll say this is not a real patient. I completely made this up, including this gentleman whose photo I got off the World Wide Web. But I wanted to give you an example of somebody that might see or might sound like somebody that you know in back. This is an older gentleman who could be a 70-year-old, but maybe a veteran, he's at a VA medical center, that he's married, he maybe has high school education, maybe some electrical training that he picked up. He also has cardiovascular issues, including a recent heart attack, and maybe a lot of, comes to the clinic, a lot of gastrointestinal GI complaints. Is on several medications. This is pretty common. We see people with a lot of medications. Has been prescribed a benzodiazepine about 5 months ago, so we don't know if he's actually taking that. And he's reporting about problems with panic, overthinking, also say that he's not leaving the house too often, but also mentioning that maybe he has trouble. He starts working on something and I just can't keep my mind focused on it. And you might even see that working with a person, you're having trouble keeping them focused, they're not being distracted. Maybe also is calling the primary care clinic several times a week. And then report some symptoms that, as we mentioned earlier, can be having some anxiety or not. Maybe he's saying there's some tightness in his chest, and he's out for cardiovascular history, so we want to take that seriously. So that's just the vignette I wanted to give you, and then I have a question again for you. So, do you think, so I'm thinking about some of the behavioral or psychological treatments that we have out there, do you think a behavioral treatment would be appropriate for Mr. Jones? And I wanted to see, get a show of hands here. The first option is yes, because cognitive issues appear mild. Got some hands for that. Put some hands, yeah. Yes, but modified heavily, including a caregiver or other support. Okay, so some more hands for that. Yes, and refer to primary care physician for medication consult. Let's go. No, but still refer to primary care physician for medication consult. Not that one, but that's not one. And last but not least, any one of these options might be appropriate depending on additional information acquired during the assessment, including patient family treatment. That's his whole song. Okay. So I think, I mean, based on the show of hands, I think the last one is probably making most sense. There's a lot we don't know. I think that hopefully at this point you're seeing with what will end to you. There's a lot of questions that already arise about what's going on with them, and there's a number of issues that could be going on. There was a panel in San Francisco from the Anxiety and Depression Association of America, and there was a colleague from the Netherlands who was talking about this work with panic and cognitive behavioral therapy, and how they're telling people to check out their feelings or thoughts of what's happening when they're having potentially a panic attack. And they had somebody who was riding bikes a lot in the Netherlands, was riding their bikes in the park, and they started getting tightness in their chest, and they weren't sure if it was a panic attack or cardiovascular issues. They actually checked in with a bystander, like, I'm having tightness in my chest. I'm not sure if I'm having a panic attack. Like, I need to call an ambulance. They did. I guess he was having a heart attack. So the only reason I'm saying is that we do have to be careful and not assume that everything's attributed to one thing and there's a risk. So. Right. So now let's talk a little bit about evidence-based treatment approaches. I just want to say here, we've come a long way, I think, even in the past several years in terms of behavioral treatments that are available. I think in the past, I mean, in the further distance past, maybe even decades, I think in some ways, you know, things can get normalized in certain settings just by virtue of having anxiety or depression and older adult and maybe they're not being detected, or in the past might not have been treated. I think now we have enough research evidence and knowledge in our providers to know that this is probably something we want to treat. However, I feel like it's much more recent, even in the past 5 years, that I've seen much coming out on really targeting these treatments to people with cognitive impairment. So I think the thought was, well, how are you going to teach skills to somebody who's having memory or cognitive issues? And I would argue that we shouldn't rule something out until we try out. That's the point of research. The first thing I will mention before I go to behavioral treatments, I thought was worthy of mentioning this one study. We did learn a little bit about citalopram. And again, I'm a psychologist, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on medication. But I just want to mention this study not only because some of our admired investigators are on this one, but in terms of taking citalopram for at least neuropsychiatric symptoms in people with Alzheimer's disease, that this actually, they were less likely, about half, 43% less likely to have anxiety issues at the end of the 9 weeks here. So there is a case, I think, in certain circumstances with a medical provider to potentially think about medication. But what I want to show you is also, I think there's a lot of not only promise, but some really great work that's being done that makes it more than just promising. I think probably maybe even a first preference for a lot of people. There aren't even a lot of medications. If there's potential for side effects on their cognition, which is not going to be helpful to them. So I want to talk about cognitive behavioral therapy. Now, what's really interesting, there have been several key studies that have come out, and when I go over the next few slides, I wanted to show you basically some similarities in approach. Basically, I'm showing all these studies because they all had an effect, they had a good effect. And to me, it's sort of amazing. These are studies where people had anywhere from mild to moderate dementia for CBT, which is amazing. So I laid it out here a little bit. This was compared to treatment as usual, but there's a study where they found CBT, it was a pilot study, had a greater effect on reducing anxiety in older adults with dementia. And this is a study where they had caregivers or carers involved. Now this one's interesting. This, and I included a link here for those of you who are interested in actually seeing the manual available online. But this also follows similar types of skills as the other treatments. So the reason I call there's monitoring skills, relaxation, pleasant activities, sleep hygiene, calming statements. For this one, this actually can be delivered by people that have they're not necessarily experts in cognitive behavioral therapy or dementia, which is amazing to me. You'll see some similarities here. For the most part, what I see in these three studies, they're not focusing as much on the C part of cognitive behavioral therapy, they're focusing more on the B part, which makes good sense to me, and actually based on the evidence with generalized anxiety disorder without any cognitive impairment, you see that cognitive aspects aren't supported, but it's really the behavioral. So it's not surprising to me in some ways that the behavioral is really where it's at in some of these treatments for people with dementia. Now, they certainly have caregivers who are involved to help support the learning. This study, they did CBT for Parkinson's disease, and I since found another study that maybe I can mention right now that comes up in that time. That does get attention processing intervention to target cognition as well as the ABPP, so people are doing that. For subjective memory impairment, along with elevated anxiety or depression, mindfulness-based stress reduction has great results, not only in reducing the anxiety and the depression, but also in improving memory. That's pretty awesome. That's no medication, that's mindfulness-based stress reduction. I'm really interested in problem-solving therapy, and this is a therapy that's actually used quite a bit for depression and executive dysfunction. So if people have pretty significant issues with planning and organizing and caring about their day-to-day, so I've been doing some work doing that with anxiety where there could be some executive function issues. And now in the extended data, people have some memory impairment. And then finally, with exercise, we have a colleague at IREC doing work with exercise, and we're going to look at some of the outcomes on worry and look like there's interesting effects with that. Okay. So treating anxiety could actually also improve cognition, and there are a few studies that show that. One is with an SSRI, they found there were some improvements. If you had improvements in your generalized anxiety disorder, you also saw improvements in inventory ability and memory that I mentioned that study with MDSR. And then also, I think already just having improved stress coping ability is going to help your cognitive ability, even if it's not something that's tangible on a test when you see a doctor. You're going to be better able to get around your daily life. That's where I think the problem solving therapy could really have an edge. So for conclusions, hopefully you'll all agree when you discuss them over the panel that it's important to treat older adults with cognitive dysfunction and have anxiety, and actually you can do something that's not necessarily medication. Great. Stress management, it not only can benefit the patient, but can affect same benefit to a carer, a caregiver. So one of the studies I have on right now is one of the amazing things of help not only with the anxiety, but also with their motor symptoms of depression and with their caregiver's level of anxiety. So this looks like there's evidence for CBT for anxiety and dementia and medications not being adopted. So we'll move to the next presentation. I just want to acknowledge some of my colleagues who worked together on this, including Nadia Suresh in the audience. And want to thank you for your attention.